Welcome to What's Cooking. There's one seat left just for you. Today's class, fall baking. There's a crispness in the air, and we're going to treat you to some great apple desserts. The first one we're going to make today is an apple bread pudding, and we're going to show you the slickest, easiest way to peel and core some apples. John?
First of all, these are Macintosh apples, which are only available at this time of the year. This is my little toy that I use here for peeling, slicing, and coring all at the same time. All you do is put the apple on, turn the crank, and in a second you'll see it peeling. All we have to do is take off any little extra pieces that still have skin on them.
That makes life a lot easier, doesn't it?
Cut it in half, and you have slices of apple.
Great. John has three of those to do for this recipe, and I have some butter melting in the skillet over here. We're going to saute the apples just a little bit. But one of the essentials to this recipe is fresh lemon zest, so we'll show you again how to zest a lemon. This is a lemon zester, and what you want to do is take it and pull it along the outer edge of the lemon. You want to make sure you do not go back and go over and get the white or the pith, because that's bitter. You just want to get the zest, which is the outer skin. It smells good already.
Don't get too close, or I don't want to peel and core your elbow.
Okay. And then you take a chef's knife. And if you have a little more room in your kitchen, being careful not to move my elbow. Mm-hmm. And that's all ready to go.
Well, I'm almost done over here. I just have to cut this last apple in half. How's the skillet doing over there?
The skillet is just about ready when you are. Now, these are Macintosh, as John mentioned, so they're thin apples and they cook up really quickly. So they're not going to take very long to saute in the skillet. But you want to put them in and keep them in as thin of a layer as possible. Now, the other thing that goes in this bread pudding is obviously some kind of bread product. And we're going to use 2 slices of fresh raisin bread.
And that's my cue, isn't it?
That is your cue when you're done cleaning.
Goofing around here. Okay, we'll cut some cubes of raisin bread.
You might want to mention how easy it is when you have a serrated knife to cut.
Well, I think you can see that it cuts very uniformly and easily without any trouble. The serration helps a lot. This is basically a tomato knife, and the little fork on the end is used to pick up slices of tomato or bread cubes.
Great. Okay, let's make the pudding mixture now. We have 3 eggs, and you could really do this by hand if you want, or with a whisk, but I think you'll notice that if you have good kitchen equipment, that especially in baking, it makes life a lot easier. And I think you're more apt to bake more if your equipment makes it easier for you.
That lemon zest smells great.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it? Okay, to this we're going to add 1/2 cup of unbleached flour and 1/4 teaspoon of sugar, 1/4 cup of sugar, 1/2 teaspoon of cinnamon, and 1/8 teaspoon of salt. And John, we're going to need some vanilla. Do you want to talk about it?
Sure.
Please?
I'll let you go ahead and put the vanilla in so you can start mixing. But this is actually just what it says, a bottle of vodka. And to the vodka, we added two vanilla beans. And about 3 weeks to 4 weeks later, you have the best vanilla you'll ever taste. And believe me, pure vanilla is far superior to the imitation. This is what the vanilla beans look like. They're actually the stamen of an orchid, I believe, from South America. And all you do is cut them in half, put them in the bottle, and the alcohol in the vodka is what extracts the vanilla flavor. If you look on a bottle of pure vanilla in the grocery store, it'll say 40% alcohol. Well, 40% and 80 proof are the same thing.
That's their liquor lesson for today.
That's right. More than you ever wanted to know about vanilla.
I'm impressed. The stamen of an orchid, you know. If you're ever on Jeopardy, you should do really well.
A little botany with your cooking.
Okay. Let me just scrape this down. We used 2 teaspoons of vanilla in that recipe. Now, would you like to put the apples in the souffle dish?
Sure.
This is a 1.5-quart souffle dish, and it's great for this recipe. The apples have been cooked a little bit, and they're crisp tender.
As opposed to mushy?
Right. And all the way on top there, you have one more apple.
Was hiding from me.
Great, now spread that in a single layer.
Well, I don't know about single, but I'll spread it out evenly. How's that?
That's better.
Okay.
Okay, we're gonna add to this, to really make it a pudding mixture, 1 1/3 cups of milk. Now, we're using whole milk, but you could use 2%, or you can even use skim milk. The thing to remember when you reduce the fat content in the milk for baking, especially a pudding or a custard, is that it's just going to be a little bit thinner. But if all you have in your home is 2% milk, don't go out and buy whole milk just for this recipe.
Would you like me to spread these?
That'd be great.
Cruets? No, not cruets.
Cubes. You're thinking of croutons.
Croutons, that's what I'm thinking of.
That's for apple salad. Okay, how about if you pour that over, and I'll get rid of this. You might need that.
Looks good enough to eat already.
Yeah, this is a very homey dessert, and it's really good in the wintertime. You don't have to use raisin bread. You can use any kind of a good bread that you want. The French have a dish similar to this. It's called a clafoutis, and it's really a pudding with a custard and fruit in it. But this is kind of a dessert like maybe your grandma used to make. I'll stick that in a 350 oven, and it'll take about 45 minutes to cook. And the way you test to see if it's done is you stick a knife in the center. And if it comes out clean, the custard is done and the dessert is done. Now the next dessert we're gonna do is an apple pie pan cake. A little bit different, very easy, and the best part about it is there's no butter or other fat in it. So excuse us a second while we get some
equipment change.
All right.
I'll have you plug this in since you're closer. And how many apples do I need here, Bev?
You're going to need two Granny Smiths.
Two Granny Smiths.
And we're going to need to grease this pie pan.
Okay.
We're going to do the whole thing in the food processor this time.
Okay. I'm going to show you another way to core and peel an apple. And this time I'm going to use a little tool called an apple corer, which makes the job a little bit easier. And all you do is push it down through the top, pull out the core, and usually if you miss a little bit like I did, you go in from the bottom and kind of clean up what's left of the seeds, pull out a little piece, and at this point, oh, I can see I have one more seed in there.
That's a big core.
Big core, right. At this point, I can peel this apple. Let me core them both.
One of the ingredients in this recipe is brown sugar. And when you measure out brown sugar, make sure you pack it down in your measuring cup. Keeps out the air pockets, and you get an accurate measure.
I'm going to use, this is a knife that most people don't have or really need, but I'm a glutton for punishment. I love all my toys. It's a curved paring knife, sharp on the inside, and it's great for peeling, especially apples.
You know, I need 3/4 cup of flour.
You do. How about if I hand this over to you?
That'd be great. Thank you.
While I continue my peeling process. Now, I have a little story to tell you about peeling. And I'm not sure what the reason was, but my grandfather, Schaefer, used to peel apples. I remember for Grandma Schaefer, for apple pies. And I think it must have been a game for him or to amuse me. He used to try to get them off in one piece. So to this day, when I peel an apple, I always try to get the peel off in one piece.
How you doing?
I'm doing okay. I don't know if, oh, just broke.
That's okay. Your grandfather would still be proud of you. Okay, I have in here flour, brown sugar, baking powder. I'm going to add a little bit of salt, 1/2 teaspoon to be exact. And let me put this away.
I think I just heard an apple drop from the tree.
I want to give you one tip about brown sugar before we get off the subject. Sometimes when you bring it home and you store it, it gets really hard on the inside and you basically can't break it apart. One of the easiest ways to get it soft again without throwing it out is to take your jar or whatever container it's in and put a slice of bread in it overnight and seal it up. And the next morning, take the bread out and the brown sugar will be soft. The bread absorbs all the moisture that's down in the brown sugar. Works well. Okay, we like extra bursts of flavor sometimes. And there isn't any comparison between freshly ground nutmeg and already ground nutmeg. So this is a nutmeg grater. You could use this, or you could use something similar to this to grate a whole nutmeg. And let me take this apart so you can see what one looks like if we haven't shown you before. This is a whole nutmeg. The once you peel the outer shell off, the inner layer, the first inner layer is the mace, and then the actual piece down in there is the nutmeg. Mace is in the nutmeg family. Obviously, it's a little bit milder than nutmeg is. But for this recipe, we're going to use some freshly ground nutmeg. Smells great. And
it's great on eggnog too, that fresh.
It sure is. This is a cinnamon grinder. And this has a really intense cinnamon flavor to it. So we're going to use this. Now we're simply going to mix these ingredients for a second.
You did want this pipeline greased.
Please. Just greased. Okay, and we're also going to add some vanilla. I'm going to steal this bottle away from John here. And John, I could use 2 eggs, please. Right behind you.
Right behind me. Here you go.
Thanks.
1, 2.
If you're baking and you have a lot of distractions at home, it's a good idea to just keep your eggshells out on the counter so that if you get called away from what you're doing, you have an idea of how many eggs you put in your recipe.
Especially if there's 6 or 8 of them, right?
Definitely. Okay. We're going to add the apples and let the processor chop it all up. There they go.
Makes it easy, doesn't it?
Sure does. And then how about 3/4 cup of walnuts?
Already? Here you go.
Thank you. I think I'll scrape that down.
Can I throw these shells away now?
Please.
Okay.
And if you decide you don't like nuts in this particular recipe, or you just don't like nuts, you can simply omit them and not worry about adding anything else.
I can do that.
Sure.
Now, how would you make this if you didn't have a food processor?
Okay. Either with a hand mixer or simply by hand. I would take the apples and chop them up first and put them in maybe a little bit of lemon juice, maybe a teaspoon or a tablespoon, so they won't brown so much while you're mixing the rest of the ingredients. Then again, mix your dry ingredients first, add your vanilla and your eggs, and then just with a spoon or a spatula, toss in your chopped apples and walnuts. It's really easy. But again, you'll notice there's no oil and no butter or anything like that in this. So we're going to pop that in the oven. Real easy fall desserts, and we're going to show you one more that's more traditional and just as easy.
How much time would you like on the timer?
45 minutes, please.
Okay.
Okay, the last recipe we're going to show you is baked apples, but these have a little bit of a twist to them. Instead of having a brown sugar syrup, they have pure maple syrup with them. But before we do that...
You stole my cutting board, didn't you?
The pie pancake that John just put in the oven, we're going to serve it with maple syrup, warm maple syrup. So I'm going to put a little bit in a saucepan and just heat it up. So that when we're ready to serve you, it'll be nice and warm. Okay, John, for this recipe, you're going to need 5 large baking apples. And how about if I put this pan here for you and you can move this up a little bit?
I'm ready. I'm going to do the coring like I did before. Only I'm going to leave the skin on except for half to an inch on the top. And I'll show you what I mean by that in a second. These are, again, in the Macintosh. This is a nice tart apple. The reason you take off a little bit of the skin on the top is to keep it from splitting while it's baking. I think it also has a nice look to it. How's that?
Great. One thing that you want to do with this is you want to make sure that you brush some lemon juice on here, on each apple, on the outer edge and on the inside so that they don't brown. Let me do that part.
Yeah, while I'm doing these apples.
And roughly about 2 tablespoons of lemon juice should be more than enough. So, where he peeled it, you want to cover that area. And then just go down in the core. This is a monster, this one.
That's a big one. That's mine. Number three. Now this is, there's a sauce that goes over this, right? That we're gonna put on in a minute.
Yeah, and I'll make my raisin and cinnamon mixture in a minute. Since you're on the fifth one, I'll do that now, and then
sure.
You can finish this up. Okay, what's going to go inside the apples? We're going to put a half a cup of raisins and a half a teaspoon of cinnamon. And if you have raisins at home that are a little bit old and a little bit dried out and you want to use them in baking, take them and soak them in some hot water for maybe about 15 minutes and then drain them. It really plumps them up and they have a big difference in the flavor and the taste. So there's our raisins.
The last apple I put in is also a large one, so we both get large ones.
Good. I was beginning to feel cheated there. Did you brush that last one?
I did not. I'm in trouble, aren't I?
Mm-hmm. Okay, real easy. Just spoon these down inside the core. This is a great way to get your family to eat apples if they don't particularly like them plain, or if when you tell them to eat a fresh apple they say, oh no, too healthy. Kind of sneak this in on them.
It's a good kids dish, mm-hmm. In other words.
It's a great time of year for it too. Okay. We want to pour 1 cup of maple syrup, which is 8 ounces, over these apples. John, I'll let you do that.
Ready? They look good enough to eat right now.
I want to say a couple of things about maple syrup. If you make this dish, please don't use maple flavored syrup. Make sure you get the real thing. There's no comparison in the flavor. This is a quarter of a cup of water we're adding to the bottom. Then this is going to bake for about 45 to 50 minutes until the apples are tender. And every once in a while, take it out and spoon the syrup mixture over it. And John will show you how to do that.
Alrighty.
I'll just put this aside.
And get the one out of the oven. Doesn't that look good? That is ready to eat, but I'd like to put, I'll save this to serve with, a little bit smaller spoon to baste with.
That
How often do you do?
I'd say at least 3 times, and then You'd really get the intense maple syrup flavor in there. And John, would you explain to them how to test to make sure it's done? Because the recipe says 45 to 50 minutes or until the apples are tender.
Basically, any kind of a fork. This is a small meat fork. You can see that the fork inserts nice and easily. And it's soft, but not too soft. I don't know how to describe
crisp
it.
Crisp tender, maybe?
Not crisp. You want it on the soft side, but not mush.
Okay. How about if you spoon one of those into this serving dish?
Ready?
You can use your fingers and lick them afterwards. There you go.
Some more good stuff on it. There you go.
Okay.
That one's ready to eat.
That's ready to eat. Now, do we have an apple bread pudding that's ready?
Yes, we do, through the magic of television. Obviously, you can see that we made this before since it is in a different container. And
how about if I just give you a spoon?
I'd like to use this same spoon.
You would?
That's not going to hurt anything.
Okay. We'll just get some maple syrup flavor in it.
Mm-hmm. It's still nice and warm.
This is the first recipe we made with the raisin bread and the
custard. Just a little bit more on there.
Okay. You know what you could do with this before you serve it? Put a little bit of cinnamon on it. That would be great. Okay.
All right.
Now the third recipe we're going to serve to you is the apple pie pancake.
Nice big piece. We have a hungry cameraman out there who's starving to death. That's not that big, is it?
There's always seconds. And you want to drizzle some maple syrup mm-hmm. over that? Some warm maple syrup over that right when you're ready to serve it.
You could put the syrup in a small bowl, or a pitcher, I mean, and have that at your table, too.
For extras.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Three really homey apple desserts, perfect for this kind of weather when you're inspired to do a little bit of baking and you don't want to spend a lot of time in the kitchen.
This is the decor.
I see. This kind of looks like the top of your head, doesn't it?
I knew you were going to say that.
At least you didn't say this looked like the top of mine. That's it for today. Thanks for joining us. Stop in again and find out what's cooking.
Bye.
For a copy of today's recipes, send a self-addressed stamped envelope marked Number 8, Fall Baking 1, Apples, to What's Cooking, 843 North Cleveland Maslin Road, Akron, Ohio, 44333-2174.
A little bit of me and a whole lot of you. Add a dash of starlight and a dozen roses too. Then let it rise for 100 years or two. And that's a recipe for making love. It doesn't need sugar, cause it's already sweet. It doesn't need an oven, cause it's got a lot of heat. Just add a dash of kisses to make it all complete. And that's a recipe for making love. And if you've made it right, you'll know it.
Join Travel Connections on the Costa Victoria, one of the newest cruise ships in the Caribbean. Make new friends from the Wadsworth area and around the world on this once-in-a-lifetime group cruise highlighting Cozumel, Ocho Rios, Jamaica, Grand Cayman, and Key West. For more information, contact Travel Traditions at 336-4707. We hope to see you sailing along with us.